Women make up 70% of the healthcare workforce, but only 20% of its leadership. On Her Story, we'll explore the careers of bold and influential women from Silicon Valley to Capitol Hill and learn how they've overcome the odds. I'm your host, Sandra Jane, and this is Her Story, a program where we explore what's beyond the glass ceiling. Well, I'm delighted to welcome Angela Lucan, Global President of the Hospital Business at Pfizer, and Katina Owens, the Vice President of Enterprise Strategic Alliances in the Key Account Management Group at Pfizer. Ladies, thanks so much for joining us on Her Story this morning.
Great. So happy to be here.
Thank you for having us.
You two just have phenomenal stories, which I'm excited to dig into this morning. But just kind of out of the gate, when most of us think about a global leading pharmaceutical company, we saw Pfizer lead the charge during the pandemic. Many of us don't really think about the what I'll call the non-clinical side of the house and more on the hospital side of things. And I think it's just both of you represent really unique functions in the organization. So maybe just for our audience's context, let's get them a little bit of context around what exactly your respective units are responsible for. So Angela, if we could start a little bit with you and tell us a little bit about kind of the hospital business.
Sure. So the hospital business unit is focused on exactly that, any products that are sold or distributed in hospitals. So products for ICU, products for those types of conditions that are treated in the hospital. So obviously during the time of COVID, you can imagine with hospitalization rates going up, the hospital business unit and many of the products that were sitting in the hospital business unit were critical during that time. So that kind of gives you a sense. And then my responsibilities from a commercial point of view, and I sit as part of the triad, which does end-to-end, meaning pipeline development all the way through to commercialization.
I lead a team that has two different distinct functions, but both of which innovatively partner with health systems across the U.S. And really, the premise of how we work is we look across kind of the care continuum and what the patient journey looks like. And we understand where there's gaps in care. And then we mutually align with health system partners to fill those gaps in care, really always centering on the patient as our true north. So we work with them around areas of mutual alignment for therapeutic areas where we have expertise from a Pfizer standpoint and where they have needs from a health system standpoint. So doing that from a key account management perspective through the lens, for example, of cardiovascular with AFib, and then from a strategic alliances perspective, that part of my organization works to harness what we say is the collective advantage of Pfizer. So working across all of our business units and functional areas to co-create with our health system customers on really innovative approaches to help us pave the path forward to transform the future of healthcare.
Pfizer really, you know, led the charge forward in helping us through the pandemic, and just so fascinating to learn what it was like being a leader inside the organization during this intense period of innovation. I guess maybe let's start with how did the experience both, you know, of the pandemic as it has affected all of us, but then also being within the organization, shape your approach to kind of leadership?
A lot of what we were starting to see in terms of early demand were products in the ICU setting, even before the pandemic really hit to the level it did. And that was when we started to see that something was happening in hospitals around the world. And obviously we began to know what it was only the beginning of what was really to come. And during that period of time, which was about March or April of 2020, I actually came into the role in April of 2020, in the middle of this massive crisis, as we were trying to deliver products around the world. I mean, just to kind of give you a flavor, you know, we were delivering in the US 1,000 emergency shipments per week. That is unprecedented in terms of the kind of demand that was out there. So when we think about the products that were needed for, you know, ventilated patients, for patients in ICU, those were the products that were in high urgent demand. In some cases, 600 to 800% of normal demand. So the team, in a rapid response fashion, really engaged with leading healthcare systems, engaged with hospitals to find out where their needs were, what their needs were, and then, of course, making commitments to make sure that we got the medicines to patients where they needed it. So for that period of time of 2020, It was a very intense time for everyone in the world. But I will say, you know, in terms of what the hospital business unit was able to deliver, making sure that we got medicines to patients around the world who needed them. And then during that same period of time, because we do work in the hospital setting and anti-infective and antiviral medicines sit within the HBU, we were also developing a protease inhibitor oral treatment for COVID. So that was running alongside some of the urgent care needs that we needed in the hospital setting, just to kind of give you a flavor.
So Angela, if I could just ask one follow-up to that then, you know, given that you have purview over really, you know, the whole global unit of the business, were there some interesting differences or approaches you had to employ when you thought about different countries and their approach to the hospital business?
Not necessarily different approaches, but it was being more proactive. Obviously, when we were seeing in certain markets, certain medicines, for example, in order to sedate a patient who's being ventilated, when we started to see certain demand raise in other countries, we started to proactively reach to countries that we maybe had not heard from to understand what their needs were. So I think it was really more helping us to meet countries where they were and at that time in which they were at. And some countries were still in the, I'm going to say they hadn't even hit the peak. Others were coming off the peak. Others were starting to get onto the peak. So it was really just trying to understand where countries were in their battle against COVID and where the medicines were that they needed the most and when that was going to be. So we developed a whole forecast model to help us figure out how to predict where that might be, and then working very closely hand in hand with governments and officials at the country level to help better meet their needs. But it was definitely, you know, we had a team that was working in crisis mode in terms of dealing with the here and now. We had another team that was thinking about what's going to be needed 6, 8, 12 weeks from now so that we can get ahead of it.
And so then, Katina, looking to what your team was responsible for, you were a little bit more domestically focused. How did the pandemic shape a lot of what your team's strategy was thinking about?
As we all know, in the U.S., we saw a really significant shift into virtual care. And when that shift into virtual care happened, we had really never had a patient experience where patients that were very complex to manage were trying to be managed in a virtual way. And that was putting strain on the healthcare system. And for us, we wanted to make sure that we stayed a close, had a close connectedness with our customers. So we actually have a multitude of advisory councils across Pfizer and our folks that work on the front line with all of our, you know, clinicians and our health systems. We started to get an outpouring of insights, really beyond the four walls of Pfizer, that this was really starting to become a strain because many of these patients were scared to come into the offices and be treated. They were even scared to go into emergency rooms. We saw stories surfacing where patients were having serious and catastrophic events such as strokes and heart attacks and still were hesitant to even go into an emergency room. So when we looked at conditions such as AFib, you know, those patients need to be anticoagulated. They're very used to entering back into a clinical environment very regularly to be monitored, to be educated, and that's just one example. But those patients were coming into that environment to make sure they were getting that ongoing education. So that was an example where we really leaned in and we said, how is this transforming the way that you're engaging with patients? How are you starting to train your care teams in really different ways to virtually engage with the patients? And we really did this across our therapeutic areas and a multitude of populations. And a lot of the executives that we work with, we have one advisory council that's about 20 to 25 different executives across health systems, the top 100 in the U.S., and many of these individuals are chief medical officers, chief quality officers, running their informatics departments, and we usually meet with them about once a month. We completely rewrote how we were going to be engaging with them to understand now how their positions were evolving. And many of them were also leading task forces for COVID, or they were leading different sub teams within the COVID task force. So they were really able to share with us how this was impacting the way they were approaching the management and the risk for COVID, and then how it was having this halo effect of how it was impacting their care management across their population so we could partner in really different ways. The other thing I would mention, Sanjula, is I think everybody can relate, this not only impacted healthcare, this impacted everyone's workforce. We very, very quickly, just like healthcare delivery, went to virtual. We also had workforces that completely went to virtual. And that was no different within Pfizer, including our folks that work face-to-face with our customers. They were now trying to figure out on a dime, how do I do this in a virtual environment with customers that were having a strain, but we knew that our lean-in partnership was more critical than ever, because no one person had the solution for what we needed to do. It was really about working together to do what's best for the patient and figure all of this out. So we had to make sure that our internal colleagues had balance, making sure that we had breakaway time, making sure that we were celebrating those joy moments, so that we also kept emotional and mental well-being front and center.
That's just so remarkable. And as you both mentioned, I mean, there was no playbook for any of this. And so I'm curious, you know, as a leader and from a personal point of view, how did all of this really change your perspective of how you manage and lead your teams and how you're thinking about, you know, what shifts you're going to make going forward?
I think the other piece that I'll just say is, you know, also thinking about having much more flexibility in the way in which we engage. You know, we went, as Katina mentioned, from, you know, a nearly very limited virtual to nearly 100% virtual in a split second. And so I think everybody was trying to figure out, how do I balance this at home? Because now I'm working from home. I got my laptop in front of me all day long. And what worked for one person didn't necessarily work for another. So I think as leaders, we need to be more flexible and agile to make sure that we are working in a way that works for a working mother at home, or someone who's single at home, or someone whose husband is working at home or not working at home, so that you could adapt and make sure that everybody had it fit into their lives to the best way that it possibly can. So I will say it's made us think very differently about how we engage, made us think very differently about how we allow for flexibility. And maybe the other piece I'll just say is also made us think more broadly about whether or not that role really needs to be in headquarters, or does that role really need to be located in the office right next door? So I think that we are opening up much more opportunities for virtual employees in a different kind of way for roles that maybe before we hadn't even thought of to be virtual. So I think it's been an evolution, and I think that it's allowed us to think more broadly, more flexibly.
And Katina, I know that even before the pandemic, a lot of your team was virtual, and so you were already in that cadence to some extent, but how has the pandemic really changed your approach to leadership?
Yeah, I agree with everything Angela said, and I think in addition to that, I would add that it's really, I think, heightened the awareness on the importance of connectedness with your teams. And you started to have this merging, right? Because you're projecting into people's homes. You're not sitting in an office room, in a room face to face in an office. You're virtually engaging, which sounds really great, but then you're 6 months in, you're a year in, you're a year and a half in, and we started to see burnout. We started to see stress surfacing across the board with a multitude of colleagues where these were really different environments for them. So from a leadership perspective, being able to make sure that you're picking up on those people signals, really being empathetic, really being compassionate, I think it dialed up the importance of one-on-one time with your people, making sure that you're listening, you're learning, and then you're leading. Making sure that you're just pausing on that work conversation and asking people how they're doing, and making sure that you let them know, not only is it okay for you to break away, I want you to. When you take vacation, shut your laptop down. I don't want you to check an email, set the phone down. It'll all be here when you get back. We're a team, we've got this covered for you, but you have to be able to completely disconnect because everyone was running at such a high speed. And that's our strength. But any strength taken to an extreme can become your weakness. And if we have burnout, then everybody can't be at their best. I would say the second leadership learning is during times of uncertainty. And we still have moments of uncertainty right now with the Delta variant. We still have, you know, folks working virtually. We have people returning to virtual that were just starting to return to the office. So the importance from a leadership perspective when you have uncertainty is you can't control and make that certain for everybody, but you can be clear. So making sure that you communicate in a really clear way, here's the goals, here's the priorities, everything's not a priority, And when you're juggling, which one of these balls are rubber and which one are glass? So we know which ones would bounce and can be put on the back burner and which ones can't. And you've got to keep them in the air so you can help folks really figure out a path forward on the right priorities and keep that balance and making sure that they're really clear on what they need to be leaning in on.
That's very well said. And I'll just say, you know, on behalf of our audience, I mean, really thank you to both of you and your teams and the entire organization for really everything that the organization continues to do to give us some sense of certainty during this, you know, really difficult time. So shifting gears a little bit, Katina, I want to come back to something that you shared earlier. I've personally had the honor of working with you and your team for several years now, and I know that your division actually didn't exist many years ago, and it's a really a new function that you've spearheaded bottoms up. Tell us a little bit about kind of what that process and what inspired that movement and just some of the context around that.
Yeah, so I'll talk a little bit about the Enterprise Strategic Alliances Group, and it is a first of its kind team, built from the ground up, as you said, and it's really exciting, and I think it's a reflection that Pfizer is a very innovative company, and we also know that what we did yesterday doesn't mean that that is what we need to do for tomorrow to be successful and be the partner of choice. And in everything we do at Pfizer, the patient is always our north. So we really ground everything we do on what is best for the patient. How do we fill those gaps in care? And the Enterprise Strategic Alliances team is about understanding in a business unit or therapeutic area agnostic way, where do we have frameworks? Where do we have protocols that we see transcending patient populations that really are much more complex to operationalize when you go into a health system or a healthcare environment? So we saw this far reaching across Pfizer. And when you look at things such as pathways, protocols, when you look at the infusion of more real world evidence and informatics playing much more of a standardized role to help reduce variable care across care continuums, you start to see a pattern that regardless of which patient I'm looking at, when you try to figure out how you build those care pathways, how you identify the gaps in care, how you fill those gaps in care, and then how you hardwire it and how you operationalize it and make sure care teams are educated, there were consistencies. And instead of doing that 10, 20 times within each therapeutic area, the Enterprise Strategic Alliances team really identifies those systematic processes and procedures that are needed.
Right. I mean, that's just so well said. And, you know, I've seen that firsthand and the effect that it's had on the industry. So kudos to you for leading that charge. I guess it really begs this broader question. You know, when we think about innovation, there is this perception that, you know, larger, more established organizations, you know, it's just harder to lead some of these transformational changes. And I think you both see that in your from your respective vantage points. I guess I'll start with you, Angela. Like, what advice would you have for other leaders who are really trying to, you know, shake things up and, you know, kind of ground up, start some of these new initiatives that may be a totally different way of practice for the organization?
Yeah, and I just wanted to pick up on something as Katina was talking about the enterprise work. You know, I think what's great about the way in which we're structured at Pfizer is it's a balance of both, right? In some ways, you have to allow for the innovation and the creativity at a BU level, right? We are structured by business unit, and we are structured that way in order to decentralize decision making. So the decision making can be made at a therapeutic level, for example, in the hospital business unit. So we have, you know, end to end commercial development all the way through to launch. That allows for that level of innovation to be able to take place, and so that we can make decisions. What Katina talked about is, look, there's a lot of value in being very focused, but then there's also things that you're going to miss unless you're looking across that business. And it's a nice kind of combination of both. So when I think about, you know, the ability to be able to innovate, you got to be able to identify what are those things in which are strengths in which you can focus on, and then what are the things that can be centralized that will allow or enable, you know, that innovation to be able to be operationalized. I would probably say that, you know, in addition to thinking about how you structure and how you govern that in terms of being able to give people the freedom and the flexibility to do that kind of innovation, to delegate accountability and decision making there, I think the second piece is having passion for the thing in which you're innovating. You know, I've seen so many interesting and good ideas die because nobody was the cheerleader or the champion of that. And in the end, you, if that's something that you truly believe in, that can change the way in which we work, can change and impact a patient's life, got to have someone who's going to be willing to champion that. And I found that if you do and you are persistent, you'll find a way to bring it through. There's many times in which, you know, Pfizer's a big company, you know, to be able to bring that level of change, you know, gosh, can that really be done? It can be done. You just got to be passionate and persistent, and you will find engagement inside the organization to make that happen. But I do think making sure and identifying clear roles and accountability is important, because if people don't know, well, can I make that decision or do I have to go somewhere else? Then that's where ideas start to kind of wane, and then they never gain the traction that they probably deserve. So those are some things that I've seen work really well in the organization, having more clarity and role. And two, in addition to giving people that accountability and responsibility, is being passionate about the thing you want to really fight for and fight for it.
I mean, I think underlying that, it made me think of, it's really like this mindset. And, you know, I was just having a conversation with my team last week around, think of yourself as a founder and that this organization is just giving you resources to go out and, you know, chart that course. And so I think that resonates very much with what you're saying. Katina, I mean, I was with you at some of the early days, and, you know, you make it sound so easy, but maybe, you know, share some of those stories from those early days of, you know, when you were trying to bring stakeholders internally and externally along for the ride and try to communicate this vision that you had.
When we were creating the vision, we created it collectively across a multitude of team members and teams within Pfizer. And I think Angela did a beautiful job outlining that it's a balance, right? So the strength of the Enterprise Strategic Alliances team, for example, which is one part of my team, is that we do partner and work so closely with those BU teams that own the business and those subject matter experts. And it's really about understanding the needs and where our goals are there, and linking those subject matter experts with the right subject matter experts externally. And Pfizer is a very large company. That's a strength for us, but navigating a very large company like Pfizer that has not only the six business units, but a multitude of departments across medical, clinical, research, policy, public relations, communications. And there's actually aspects of those partnerships that touch across all of those areas. So it helps us support big thinking, and it also helps streamline that engagement for the customer. So we did it together when we formed the vision. And I think that's really important, because you really need to have clarity and inclusiveness with the vision. But it certainly doesn't make it easy. So when you try to tackle that and you start to have an experience where you're harnessing the collective advantage of Pfizer, sometimes there's speed bumps along the way. But anytime you innovate, if your palms aren't sweaty at least once or twice, you're probably not innovating. And you're probably going to have a good conversation here or there. Even when you upstream outline roles and responsibilities, when you get into the thick of actual execution, sometimes those things still have to be worked through. And I think that's where trust comes into play. And at Pfizer, we really have, you know, our values that we kind of use as a cornerstone of how we engage internally and externally. And I think the integrity of how we work, the respect for others, and making sure that that really instills trust in the relationships, especially when you innovate, because innovation is more draining and it's more difficult, and innovation isn't appropriate everywhere. So is there clarity on where we're doing it, why we're doing it, the roles around it? Then when we start, we have a togetherness that it's not going to be easy. And sometimes when you feel conflict, then we have to take a pause and talk through it. And what we have found is when we come together this way and we really listen to each other, the overall collective advantage of Pfizer is one of our most powerful assets that we can harness. So it's not easy, but I think at the heart of this success is a really great culture. It's openness, it's inclusiveness, it's talking through it. And sometimes when you're paving that path that has never been paved before, there's going to be conflict, there's going to be some uncertainty, and you have to work through it. You have to talk through it, and you have to figure out the path forward together.
You know, I think one of the things that you mentioned on the kind of conflict and subject matter expertise, and I don't know if either of you have experienced this, but I think there is this perception that, you know, really the core product of Pfizer is a clinical therapeutic. And I think what's so powerful is that the two of you have a very different training and background. It's not clinical. And so I'm curious how having more of a business development perspective has shaped your approach to leadership and your ability to lead some of these changes inside a, you know, clinically focused organization.
I definitely do not have a traditional pharma background. I actually started off as a teacher. I was a junior high school teacher in the New York City public school system, and ended up opening up my own business. And I was an entrepreneur for many years. And I loved that. I loved being in startup. You have to be passionate about it. You've got to be relentless in terms of your dedication. But I do think that having that experience really taught me about the importance of growing something and building something. And that's what ended up leading me into the pharmaceutical area. I ended up going on the advertising side of the business. And then from advertising, ended up switching over to the marketing side of the business. But I will say that that business mindset of building something, about leaving something better than the way in which you found it, about building an employee base and a team and doing something that had not been done before, that was something that I brought with me when I joined Pfizer. And the ability to impact patients was something that spoke very much to me because of my background and how I was raised. Breakthroughs that change patients' lives, when we think about that vision for Pfizer, it spoke to me. And I've been with Pfizer ever since through the Wyeth acquisition and others. And I really feel like I can make a change, a meaningful impact in the lives of patients, a meaningful impact in the lives of employees and the people we work with. And that was something that I think having my own business and being an entrepreneur really, I got an opportunity to thrive and do that here at Pfizer. Even though people think, well, Pfizer, gosh, it's a big company, can't bring that kind of change. You can. I think Pfizer is absolutely asking for that when we think about the leaders in the organization wanting to innovate, wanting to change and make sure that we adapt so that we can fulfill our vision on bringing breakthroughs that change patients' lives. And the only way which we can do that in this kind of environment is to innovate and to push ourselves into areas that maybe we haven't done before. And if COVID taught us anything, it said, wow, you could do almost anything. I mean, think about, you know, the things we're doing today that we wouldn't even dreamt about before. The ability to bring products to market in record speed that we would never have thought before. The ability to be able to work 100% virtually, which we'd never would have even probably piloted in that respect. So we're doing a lot of things that we've never done before. And I think the company is starting to see the ability that can bring as we start rethinking the way in which we've been doing things for such a long period of time. And I think Albert and the vision of the company is definitely moving in that direction of anything is possible. And we're going to have to transform and change our way of thinking if we really want to bring innovation to the market faster. And I don't just mean products. I mean the way in which we work. I mean the employee base and how we think about it. I'm talking about end to end, you know, everything that makes up an organization, from our culture, our people, our products, and the services that we provide.
Building on that point, the pace of change aspect is really remarkable. And so I'm curious how both of you think about, you know, will we be able to sustain that pace of change moving forward? And as a leader, how do you think about, you know, the balance between, you know, crisis mode innovation to kind of actually doing things differently and faster, you know, as the new normal, so to speak?
Yes, as long as we prioritize what we're trying to change. If you try and change everything, then no, you can't sustain that. I think Katina mentioned it before. Pick the thing that's really important that needs to be transformed. Not everything needs innovation and transformation. There are certain things that are working really, really well. You don't have to break them in order to, you know, to get a little bit more improvement. But are there areas that are big bottlenecks? Are there areas that are big bureaucratically, internally? Are there areas that that if we could innovate, could bring innovation to the world faster? Those are the areas where I think we want to rally around in terms of bringing a pace of innovation, as long as we can be careful to prioritize, exactly for the reason that Katina mentioned before, is you don't want people to burn out, and not everything requires that level of pace of innovation. We need to pick and choose the things that have the most meaningful impact.
Yeah, I completely agree with Angela. And I think, you know, through this, we've had an amazing journey and stories, not only within Pfizer, but across our external market, of how innovation in this pace to respond to COVID has changed people forever, not only professionally, but personally. But we've also seen that if you run at that pace with every task, you'll burn out and you'll be okay at a lot of things, but not great where you need to be great. And we mentioned and had, you know, a little bit of conversation a few minutes ago around how innovation also takes more energy. It takes more focus. It's harder to tackle, if you will. So considering that, I think Angela's point around prioritization is probably one of the most important, because the balance of many teams within Pfizer is that you've got a subset of tasks and priorities where you have to innovate. Then you have others where you are really implementing from a business perspective, where you already have frameworks, you already have goals and objectives, you know what works, and you really have to balance both of those things. And it doesn't mean that innovation can't infuse with standard practice to help us do things better, but we don't need to rehaul everything, and you don't need quick pace everywhere. So balancing that and making sure that you're working through that with your leaders, with your team, making sure everyone's on the same page, I think is really important. I think too, you know, with your question a few minutes ago around the business background, one thing I think has been really, really important is diversity in thought and experiences at the table makes a very significant difference when you're really brainstorming to figure out how to tackle all of this, whether it is everyday business in the lens of this new work normal or when and how you innovate. And it's not just about position, it's about purpose. And Angela mentioned breakthroughs that change patients' lives. You know, that is really what we ground ourselves on from a Pfizer perspective. But if you unpack that, that's way beyond an asset. So you mentioned, you know, pharmaceuticals, and when folks think of pharmaceutical companies, they think of products. But we know the patient really well. We do a lot of research on the patient. We understand from a national quality forum perspective the approach to deliver optimal care. We work and co-create with customers around that. Access and affordability is critical to making sure that when we have those breakthroughs, that patients can get the breakthroughs they need quickly and be able to treat their complex conditions. All of those things are capabilities within Pfizer. So I think as long as we're grounded on purpose, you want people in the room that have business backgrounds, clinical backgrounds, medical backgrounds, informatics backgrounds. We could go on and on. It's that diversity in thought. And I think it's also the diversity of, you know, different individuals coming from different backgrounds, whether that be gender or different ethnicity, because we've also seen social determinants of health surfacing as a significant concern and opportunity across the world to help us make sure we're delivering optimal care. And the togetherness around that purpose really, I think, opens the door to welcome cross-functional collaboration and differences in thoughts like we've never seen before.
I think that purpose piece, kind of paired with Angela, your point around being a cheerleader and being just so passionate about what you're doing is really kind of resonating with what you're both saying. And I know healthcare is very personal to each of you. We love asking all of our guests on this show, you know, as you think about your entrance into healthcare and then healthcare leadership more specifically, you know, do you consider your path to be more accidental or intentional? And so I'm curious how each of you would think about kind of from the early days on what some of those influences have had on your trajectory. So Angela, maybe we'll start with you.
I'm not sure that when I was going into college that I had in my head that I would, obviously I graduated to be a teacher. So I had that in my mind in terms of what I wanted to do. But, you know, since I was young, my mom was quite ill from a very young age. And so I understood what having a chronic debilitating illness was going to be like and the kind of impact that it had on her, the kind of impact that it had on the family. And I just remember she had three different types of rheumatoid arthritis. And it had reached a point where she had like two knee replacement surgeries, and she had reached a point where now she, you know, requires the help of family to help her do simple things that all of us seem to take for granted. And it's interesting, I'm not sure that I really understood the impact of that on me until I started to tap into healthcare. I mean, I did teaching for many years. I had my own business for many years. And when I moved on the advertising side, one of the first products I worked on was an HIV product, and I got a chance to work with HIV patients. And it triggered something in me where I was like, I want to do more of this. This fulfills me. This makes me feel like I'm having an impact on patients' lives, like my mom, someone like my mom. And so once I got into healthcare, I knew that was it for me. And eventually I made my way over to Wyeth and then eventually to Pfizer. And actually, you know, interestingly enough, the product that made such a transformative change in my mom's life was a product that I eventually got to work on one day. So it just really, you know, interesting to me how my life ended up there, but not because I necessarily directed it there. But I think once I got into healthcare, I realized, oh my God, this is what I want to do, because I can help provide education, resources, tools for doctors, for patients. A lot of what I focused on in the beginning was direct-to-consumer advertising, because you could directly connect with patients about the disease. So I ended up in healthcare. My younger sister, surprisingly enough, ended up in healthcare. And my older sister ended up somewhere in healthcare as well. So it's not where either one of any three of us ended up graduating college for, but it's interesting how your life takes you into places. And, you know, I think a lot of it had to deal with what we learned and the environment that we grew up in, and also recognizing the fact that we could make an impact and help people, like in a way in which my mom was not helped in the beginning. And so anyhow, each of us seem to have found a way into healthcare, and this is definitely where I'm going to spend my career. I mean, I knew once I tapped into this, this is what I was very passionate about and the impact I wanted to make. And so I've worked in multiple different business units in oncology, in rare disease, in vaccines, now in hospital, because I feel like in each one of those, I've impacted patients' lives, but in a very different kind of way.
Wow, that's amazing to see that come full circle. And, you know, Katina, I know that in some ways your experience was probably the opposite, where you grew up in a healthcare background. How did that shape your perspective?
I think that although Angela and I have differences in how we got here, why we got here, we have a common thread, and that's the difference that we can make for the patients and the communities that we serve. So I came from a family that definitely had a lot of experience in the medical field. My father ran the ambulance service and worked the ambulance service from many different arenas, from, you know, driving it to driving the ambulance to delivering care to then eventually running it for the entire county. And that is a pretty tumultuous position, 24/7 on call. And you really hear and see the strain that that can have from a healthcare perspective. And my mother started out in nursing, and then she went from nursing to being a nurse midwife, then an OBGYN and a family practitioner. And we lived in an area that was very underserved from a healthcare perspective. The hospital shut down on multiple occasions in the same situation now, and the strain of COVID has put even more strain on underserved communities. And I mentioned social determinants of health. We didn't call it that when I was growing up, but it was everywhere. And I remember my mom would see over 100 patients a day, very, very often. And she would go in at 7 in the morning, and she would work to 7, 8, 9 o'clock at night. We would have patients that were knocking on our doors in the middle of the night because there wasn't a hospital, because they didn't have a place to go, because they couldn't afford health care. And she always opened the door and was there for them. And it was always about the community that she served. It was always making a difference. And when you look across my siblings, you know, one was in law enforcement to serve the community, the other two in healthcare. And my sister runs a lot of health aspects of healthcare for the entire school system, and making sure that underserved and underprivileged children can have food on the table, have the healthcare they need, can have clothes on their backs. So for me, when I think about the impact and the influence that's had on me, it's been profound. Because it shows that everyone doesn't have at their fingertips what they need to be healthy. And even simple things that we can take for granted, such as having food on the table, is not guaranteed for everybody, even in America. So we have to work together to make sure that our communities really have what they need to be healthy. And within underserved areas, healthcare is so important because it's really the cross-section of where everything comes together to help support your community. And I saw that with my mother. I saw multiple women speak to her in tears, and they had dropped out of high school, they already had children, and that was her path. She had multiple kids before she was 20, and she went back and she gained all of those degrees, graduating at the top of her class with 3 and 4 children at home. So it was also the passion. And Angela mentioned this earlier, the passion of knowing the purpose you serve and never, ever giving up. So the influence that's had on me when I entered into healthcare, and I have a degree in chemistry, and I could have went on and got my PhD, and I said, I don't see myself in a lab. I had also been working in clinics for multiple years when I was in high school as well as in college, volunteering. And I had a passion to help patients, and I had seen that through my upbringing. And biopharmaceuticals unfolded to be the perfect path. And I was with Searle Pharmacia, now Pfizer, through mergers and acquisitions. I've had 12 to 13 different roles across strategy, marketing, multiple aspects of business and leading teams. And at the end of the day, always being grounded in the patients and the communities that we serve, as long as you always have that as your front and center, then everyone at the end of the day will have a better outcome. And that's the passion of making sure that, you know, you don't take tomorrow for granted. And if you can make that difference today, you need to do so and lean in on making that difference.
I love when you said earlier this idea of a North Star, and I think just listening to both of you talk about your early influences, I mean, it's just so apparent that both of you have this tremendous North Star, you know, in terms of that those experiences that you had in those early days. So it just shows in every aspect of your work. As you think about where you started to where you are today, you know, it's a nonlinear process, as we've talked about, and there are a lot of ups and downs along the way. Has there been a particular difficult decision or a trade-off? I'm sure there's been many, but one that really stands out as, you know, defining to your career?
The move from the U.S. outside the U.S. was probably a big move for me. I'm first generation born in the U.S. My parents are from a country called Croatia. And I had always wanted to live and work outside the U.S., but I wasn't quite sure exactly how to get there. And then one day, obviously, as Wyeth and Pfizer were merging, an opportunity came up to relocate to Switzerland. Had never been there, don't know how to speak the language, knew nothing about the country, but I had an opportunity to relocate, and I did. And I will say it changed me in many ways. Number one, it definitely took me out of my comfort zone. Working in a country, like I said, that I didn't know anybody or even speak the language, and had to integrate two organizations together, the Wyeth organization and the Pfizer organization. And I think you learn a lot about yourself when you get put into those types of, like, what's important to you, what drives you, what makes you, you know, what are the leadership qualities and skills that are important to you? How do you bring culturally two organizations that on a piece of paper had a similar culture, but in reality were very different than one another? And I think that move into an environment in which I was dealing with things on so many different angles that I had just never dealt with before. You know, oftentimes in your career, you're dealing with one or two things that are different or unique, or you take a new role and there's something about it that's unique. I think in this one, there was everything had changed. And for me, that was probably a defining moment for me that I think changed me in terms of what's important to me and how to lead an organization through that kind of level of change that I'm not sure I would have learned about myself had I not really taken the plunge to do something very different.
As a mother of two, I will share with you one situation that I think of often anytime I have a lot on my plate. And it was many years ago, probably almost, 18 or 19 years ago. And I had two kids in diapers. And at that time, I was a district manager and I had an entire state. And we were onboarding at Pfizer. I had went through a lot of training. I had been away from home a lot. And I was out across the market. And I remember I came home and I was sleeping and something woke me up. And I could hear this noise down the hall. And, you know, I said to my husband, "You hear that? I think there's somebody in the house." And he says, "No, I don't hear anything. Go back to sleep." And that mother's intuition just kept gnawing at me. So I said, "I'm going to get up and walk down the hall and see what's going on." And my office light was on and I could hear my kids talking. And it was the middle of the night. And I thought, "What is going on?" And I cut the corner and I looked and they had gotten the kid lock open on the window. And my son was hanging onto the windowsill. We were on the second story of the house. And my daughter was climbing up the bookshelf, handing him books, and he was throwing them out the window. And it was all my Pfizer files. It was all my work papers. There was snow on the ground. I could see the wind blowing papers all over the cul-de-sac. And my heart just stopped, number one, because the window was open and I had two kids in diapers in front of the window. So I didn't yell, I didn't react. I very calmly walked over until I could get my hands on both of them and make sure that they were safe. But they were literally trying to throw my work out the window. And when I reflected on that, I realized it. And that to me was an eye-opener and it was a lesson that I learned. It was a lesson of making sure that I was present in everything I was doing. So I still needed to get in the car and work across the markets and have overnights away from home. But when I came home, I needed to be home. And when I was in the market with my team, I needed to be in the market with my team. And I wasn't striking that balance. And I'm so grateful for that lesson. I'm so grateful that I was able to get my kids and no one was hurt. But I'm so grateful for the be in the moment lesson that that taught me. So then from that point on, I really had a different understanding of the impact that that was having. So to make every single moment count, when I came home, everything went to the side, and I would get on my knee and I would look my kids in the eye, and I wanted to hear about their day, and everything else I put to the side. So this was my time with them, making sure that when you have that balance, it's not just about, I'm not going to take a meeting after 5. You need to not take work whenever you walk away, and you need to make sure you engage and you're there. So that was a turning point for me, and it's actually a conversation and a story that I've shared with a lot of working parents, men and women, because I think everyone struggles with that balance, especially when you take on a leading of teams role, when you have more travel and it's more demanding. So I have always taken that with me, and I've also tried to share it.
Well, thank you for sharing that. I mean, I've had the privilege of actually meeting both of your kids at this point now, and I'll say that I know that they're very proud of you, and your parenting and that balance has really paid off. So, I think it all worked out in the end. Angela, I mean, I guess same question, the balance piece, I put balance in air quotes because I don't really ever believe that there is such thing as true balance, but as you've thought about, your expanded leadership roles over the years, how have you been able to prioritize, personal and professional?
For me, it's about just about knowing what's important to you, and putting those guardrails in place. Like I know for me, nothing over the weekend. When that I work during the week, but when that Friday comes, the computer shuts down, and that's it. Unless there's a crisis or emergency, I'll tell the team, like if something happens where it's a crisis, text me because I'm not checking emails. So I think putting boundaries in place that give you those guardrails, especially now with the whole virtual environment where your laptop is in your living room, where you hear that beep go off or buzzer and you're like, oh, I got an email. It's so hard to not, to disconnect, but I think you have to. Katina talked about we have something called breakaway moments, right? Or take back 10, where we're taking back time for ourselves, whether that be to walk around the block, to go to the grocery store, to jump on a bike, or to just do something that's not on this computer looking at the screen. And also what I said was important, what's important to you, focus on that and make sure that you're making decisions based on that, not based on your career. There were many opportunities when I was living in Switzerland to take on bigger roles, many bigger roles that presented themselves to me. And at that time, I just said, nope, I have, for personal reasons, I now don't want to relocate away from Switzerland. I want to stay here. And if that means that I'm going to give up, career opportunities down the road, I'm okay with that. Know what's important to you. There are going to be times in your life where you're going to need to balance that and, based on what's important for you, for your family. But don't be afraid to prioritize yourself. I think oftentimes we think, well, gosh, if I don't take that role, will another one come up? Yes, another one will come up. Opportunities present themselves all the time. Know what's important to you and stick with that. I am so glad that I didn't relocate then, that I gave myself that opportunity to stay in Switzerland and to work out what was important to me personally. Because if I didn't, now I'd be looking back and regretting, well, what if? So I feel like, be okay with that, because I think sometimes we think, well, gosh, if I don't take this now, it won't come again. It'll come again. It may be a different opportunity, but opportunities will present themselves. So know what's important to you, prioritize, and also have a conversation with your family. It's not just you. Make sure that this works for your family when those opportunities present themselves. How many times I've relocated husbands and or wives to different countries, and I always say, is your partner on board? Are you sure your partner's 100%? Because in the end, you're a family unit. If one person is unhappy, and it just so happened there were certain circumstances where they hadn't had that conversation, and within 9 months, they were already relocating back to the US. So, know yourself, know your family, have those open conversations, and it's okay. And please prioritize yourself and your personal time. Because as, Katina mentioned before, you only live once. And for me, my family's the most important. A lot of the reasons why I relocated were personal reasons for my family. One of the reasons I came back here to the US was because I wanted to be closer to my mom and dad. They're reaching an age now where they need more support and help. So for me, family always comes first. And I find a way to fit all those other pieces in there. But you got to have some of those guardrails in place. Otherwise, my goodness, how quickly work can bleed into more and more of your personal time. It's already taking up so much time. You got to make sure you put in some of those, like I call guardrails, to protect yourselves. Otherwise, you could end up working 24/7.
That's great perspective. So I have so many more questions, but I know we're hitting up against time. So maybe a final question for each of you, and I'll pose a different one for each. So Katina, curious, is there one something that you believed early on in your career that you no longer believe?
It's a great question, and probably evolution in thoughts on many fronts through learnings. They always that age-old saying that experience is the one area where you take the test first, then you get the notes. So I think that causes you to have evolution in thoughts on a few perspectives or a few topics. I would say, Sanjula, when I came in to lead people, I think I thought that everyone would just, be thinking of you as a leader, as a team, everyone coming together. And I didn't probably really think through the magnitude of impact of being a female leader. And I remember when I took my first region as a female leader, I was leading with the team and I had a very tenured manager on the team. And after about 6 months, he approached me and he said, "I got to give you some feedback." He said, "When you first started, I had done some homework and I was told that you were very business driven. You didn't have kids, you weren't married, and it was going to be living, eating, breathing, sleeping, work." And I was shocked. I was shocked that that was the perception because coming into this, I never would have thought, to your question, that anybody would have thought differently. So I wanted to understand that and unpack that a little bit. And we ended up having a great conversation. And he said to me, "You are the first female regional leader I've ever had in my career." And he had been with the company for almost 30 years. And he said, "It's been one of the best leadership experiences that I've had. You have two kids. You've been married to your husband for almost 20 years at that time." And he said, "It was just a perception that got here before you did. And I'm so thankful that I had the opportunity to work and work for and within a team that did have a female leader because I learned so much." So my takeaway from that was not to assume that when you are kind of breaking some barriers from a gender or from any other perspective, that everyone has had that experience or thinks the same way. And the other impact that had on me that really shaped the way I think and the way I lead is being an example to others that you can have the balance, that you can take on those leadership roles, and that when we tackle things such as gender equality and other things, that it's okay to have that conversation. Let's make sure that we talk with each other. And within those inner circles of solutions, it's not just females, it's male and females. It's people of all different backgrounds from an ethnic standpoint, a gender standpoint. And let's make sure we have that inclusiveness. And in fact, as you know, from a research perspective or from an experience perspective, the more diversity you have and the more inclusion you have, the stronger your results are, the stronger your team is. So that's been ever shaping for me, Sanjula. I went on to lead the Women's Field Network for 2 years. And one of the overarching kind of themes within that 2 years was bringing men into the inner circle and doing this together. And we had to have a lot of conversation of, well, why would I be invited to a Women's Field Network? Which let us know that is exactly the conversation we should be having because we're all in it together. So I would say that's been an evolution in thought and approach. And I'm so grateful for the learning because it also sets the stage for others in the future to be able to take on more leadership and more inclusiveness in their teams.
And so, I guess, final question then, Angela, you've already accomplished so much in your career. And so, I guess the question is, what is one thing that you have yet to accomplish that you would like to as you think about the next phase of your leadership journey?
I guess for me, well, one of the things that I'm working on now is the COVID therapeutic. There's not many times in your career where you work on something that has the opportunity to truly transform the world and society, and this is one of those. So when I think about that, that is something I'm very passionate about when I think about, a breakthrough that can change patients' lives. So that I would say on the therapeutic side, On the personal side, as Katina mentioned before, I also had a very interesting experience when I moved to Switzerland about the role of women in business, or I should say at that point, maybe lack of role of women in business. You know, in Switzerland, the last canton finally allowed women to vote in 1980. So it speaks a little bit to the role that they saw of women in business. And I remember at the time doing a seminar internally for women in leadership, and what a ripple effect that caused, and not necessarily in a positive way, and how it took education, transparency, communication to bring both men and women to the table to have that conversation. And it made me realize, my goodness, we still have a significant road ahead of us. And since then, I've been part of HBA, the Healthcare Business Women's Association, now for over 20 years. I was part of the board for the Healthcare Business Women's Association in Europe. And for me, one of the personal things that I want to continue to work on is continue to drive opportunities for women in this industry. We have the HBU Women's Collective, which exactly what Katina talks about is identifying not only women and mentoring and opportunities, but bringing in men as allies to help provide mentoring opportunities for them. So as I think about two things that I would really love to think about accomplishing from a career point of view, one is the opportunity to truly make a global impact in terms of COVID, and the second one is truly make it a global impact for women in business. And I think part of the things that tie Katina and I together is exactly that passion and that motivation, and we all play a role in that, and it requires education, communication, and action. We have to do something about it.
Oh, I love that. That's just so powerful. Well, thank you both, Angela and Katina, for spending some time with us. I mean, this is exactly why we created Her Story, to share these stories and reflections and lessons learned. So just know that your insights are going to continue to support those goals that both of you have in elevating the next generation of female leaders.
Thank you.
Thank you, Angela.